So someone showed me this video the other day by this channel, an open letter, and when I watched it, I couldn't tell if he was criticizing homeopathy or if he was being supportive. He definitely lists out some of the criticisms of homeopathy, but in the end, concludes in favor of it, despite all the criticisms. So I watched the video again, this time carefully seeing how he's making every point in the video, and I think what he's done is dangerous. We need to talk about it. Hi, you're watching Science is Dope. My name is Pranav and I'm here saying, bro, if you want to misinform the public about science, then you'll have to go through me first. If you watch the video, you'll see he's chosen his words very carefully throughout the video so as to seem very neutral. He's like, hey, here are the criticisms of homeopathy, but let me assure you, there are good things as well. You need not worry. That's the problem with this video. The danger lies in the subtlety of its messaging. The videos that are openly supportive of homeopathy, it's easy to watch out for them. But it's videos like these that are harder to watch out for. The most dangerous punches for a boxer are the ones he can't dodge. Even if you were being neutral and you took an objective look at all the criticisms, then the conclusion you make would not be in favor of homeopathy. So let's get into the video and see what fallacies he's making. But before that, we need to understand what exactly is bad about homeopathy. The problem with medicine is this. A person is sick, he takes something and he gets better. These two events happen one after the other, and this leads people to conclude that one caused the other. This right here is a fallacy because the medicine need not have caused the improvement. It could have been caused by something else. The fallacy is called post hoc ergo propter hoc, Latin for after this, therefore because of this. Now, we don't want to fall into this fallacy and think that the medicine works. We want to make sure that it actually works, that the medicine is what cured the sick person and not something else. So how do we do that? We perform what's called a double-blind randomized placebo-controlled trial. All medicines have to undergo this kind of trial, whether it's from modern medicine or homeopathy or Ayurveda, before it gets a seal of approval saying, hey, this medicine does what it's designed to do. Because these trials help us answer two things. Is the medicine actually effective? And we're not just thinking it's effective because the patient got better. And is it safe to use? I'm not gonna go into detail on trials here. You can watch this video where I've done that. I want to focus on this placebo part here. What does that mean? Say you're sick and I give you medicine, but without you knowing, I'm actually just giving you plain water, but flavored to make it taste like medicine. But from your point of view, you're actually getting medicine and you'll expect to feel better. This expectation that you feel can actually make you feel better without any medicine. And this is called the placebo effect. And this thing that I'm giving you is called a placebo. The effect itself is mostly psychological and it's unreliable. So doctors never use it to treat patients. And it's almost always temporary. For example, if you have pain and you get a placebo, you might for a while feel that this pain is gone or it's reduced. But after a while, it might come back just as strong. And the placebo effect is a feature of literally every kind of medicine there is. Modern medicine, homeopathy, Ayurveda, you name it. And it can be with medicine that's eaten or drunk, or maybe it doesn't even involve eating or drinking. Maybe it's a process where someone does something to you that supposedly has some medical outcome. Therefore, the minimum effect of a medicine is not zero, it's the placebo effect. This little fact has to always be taken into account before testing any medicine. This is why medical tests always contain two groups. To one group, we give the placebo, and to the other, we give the actual medicine that we want to test. Only if the medicine group performs better than the placebo group does the medicine actually pass the test. Now, have such tests been conducted in the case of homeopathy? Yes, they have. And what do they say? That homeopathy has no effect other than the placebo effect. There are a few studies that say that homeopathy has some clinical effect, but those are all from homeopathy organizations and bodies that make these studies in an effort to desperately stay afloat when literally every other source, evidence from every other source is against them. The conclusion from all this is clearly not in favor of homeopathy. And if you do conclude in favor of homeopathy after all this, then either you're extremely stupid or you're willfully misleading your audience. And I don't think he's stupid. So let's see what kind of mental gymnastics he's pulling in the video in order to conclude in favor of homeopathy. He begins by laying out some statistics about homeopathy and talks about how its market is growing so much worldwide and how the Indian government not only supports it but has an entire ministry for it. And he concludes by saying that despite its popularity, there are so many people that still criticize it. And right here you find the first fallacy of the video, an appeal to popularity. Just because an idea is popular doesn't make it good. I can give you countless examples of bad ideas that were popular at different times in different parts of the world that turned out to be either wrong or outright terrible. The only reason an idea is good is if it has convincing evidence in favor of it. And for homeopathy, there is none. One of the main reasons it survives is because of the placebo effect and people's poor understanding of it. And the Ayush ministry, man, don't get me started. I think the Indian government is a hub for pseudoscience and the Ayush ministry is at the heart of it all. I'm gonna be making a video on this topic in the future. It's gonna be pretty epic. If you don't want to miss that, hit subscribe. Now, where were we? He then explains the origins of homeopathy, the story of how Samuel Hahnemann was so frustrated with the medical practices at the time, like drilling holes in people's skulls to cure a headache, or induce vomiting to cure digestive issues, or bloodletting to cure a fever. He was so frustrated with all this that he came up with the theory of homeopathy. First of all, I agree, there were a lot of terrible practices at the time, and they probably all came into the mainstream because someone somewhere tried it and it worked for them. And they thought that forcing themselves to vomit worked for me, so it's gonna work for everyone else. The solution to this would have been more testing and more rigor to see what actually works, and not creating a whole new method that may have had some pleasant methods, but again made the same mistake of making a lot of new assumptions and not rigorously testing. This is what Hahnemann did with homeopathy. He said that these treatments, which were opposite to the disease, aka allopathy, were bad. We have to give medicines that are similar to the disease, that is homeopathy. So one idea was that what causes the disease in a healthy person also can cure the disease in a sick person. In addition, he said that the more dilute a medicine is, the stronger it is. How? Because it's not the ingredients of medicine that healed the sick, it's a supernatural vital force that had the power of healing. And making medicines more dilute only made this vital force more potent. And where did he get this idea? Like I said, assumptions with no testing to see if it's actually true. And so we'd get these medicines that are so dilute to the point where they're just pure water if they're liquid, or pure sugar if they're solid, no medicine in them whatsoever. Hey, but it has vital force. And because he had no knowledge of the placebo effect, whenever one of his patients got better, he would assume it's because the medicine worked. To be honest, you can't really blame Hahnemann for coming up with ideas like an unseen vital force, because they were kind of prevalent at the time. And it's not just him, nobody back then knew how to conduct rigorous testing. Nobody had any knowledge of molecules and stuff. We didn't know that so much dilution would remove any active medication. The people you have to blame are the ones who uphold what Hahnemann wrote in 1810 as a holy book and practice things today exactly as he wrote them back then. Back when we thought that sickness and healing were supernatural. Back when we had no knowledge of germ theory. Oh yeah, did I mention that homeopathy to this day has no concept of germ theory? In an age where we have seen germs causing disease and we have very successful methods of fighting these germs, can you believe that a system of medicine exists that doesn't even consider the existence of germs? By the way, he keeps calling modern medicine allopathy throughout the video. Allopathy doesn't exist anymore. It's a name that Samuel Hahnemann gave the heroic medicine of the time. Call it modern medicine. I know the term allopathy is popular in India, but generally, from what I've seen, the people who say allopathy tend to be alternative medicine apologists. Like this channel. He also talks about how allopathy at the time had no germ theory. So I'm sure in his research, he would have learned that homeopathy also has no germ theory, even today. So why did he choose not to include this little detail? Or did he choose to willfully ignore it because it would go against the message of the video? When he talks about the criticisms of homeopathy, I have to give him some credit where it's due. He mentions some of the points correctly. He talks about Avogadro's limit beyond which dilution cannot take place. He talks about how water memory is a flawed concept. There are a few he doesn't mention, like the lack of a germ theory, the lack of rigorous testing, and the lack of studies showing any evidence beyond the placebo effect. But I wouldn't say he did a bad job of listing out the criticisms. But that's it. He just lists out the criticisms and doesn't infer anything from that and just moves on to conclude the whole video. If that isn't disingenuous, I don't know what is. One good point he makes in the video is that homeopathy is unpopular among those with a scientific temper, and that scientific literacy or education is not the same as scientific temper. This is a good point. I'm not sure why he mentioned it, because it kind of undermines his whole video, but I appreciate that he did. Towards the end of the video, he talks about how homeopathy consultations are long and help patients psychologically. That's true, but then again, that's true even in modern medicine. If a doctor provides longer, dedicated consultations to patients, that would be true anywhere. But the problem is there are far too many patients compared to doctors, especially in government hospitals. But you go to private hospitals and you'll see this is not the case. But this is often not affordable to many people, and I agree, affordability is a valid criticism of modern medicine. And another criticism that I've heard about modern medicine is about side effects, which is again a valid criticism. If you take a vaccine and you experience fever or a body pain the next day, yeah, that's an unwanted side effect. But you know how modern medicine manages it? Using a risk-benefit analysis. No modern medicine doctor would ask you to take medicine if the side effects of the medicine are not worth the benefits that the drug gives. But wait, how do you know all these side effects? Using rigorous testing, something that alternative medicine doesn't really have. And medical science is also aware that nobody likes side effects. And so research is constantly being done to develop drugs that have little to no side effects at all. And I often hear from these homeopathy apologists that homeopathy is a solution, it has no side effects. Do you know why that is? How can you have side effects when you don't have any effect at all? You have to have some active ingredient in the medicine to have any effect. Also, modern medicine is often reduced to just drugs, medicines and prescriptions. There's so much more: surgery, dietary advice, physiotherapy, psychotherapy, palliative care, end-of-life care, etc. All of which you wouldn't be aware of if you're familiar only with the world of homeopathy. Now, I've listed criticisms of homeopathy and modern medicine, and if you compare the two, you'll see a stark difference. And this diagram will hopefully help you understand it better. See, for any medicine, the importance of it should be judged in the following categories: effectiveness, availability, affordability, and patient experience. With the most important thing being the effectiveness of the medicine. Because unless the medicine is effective, there's no question of the other categories. And making the medicine effective is where most time and money is spent during its research and development. And while most of modern medicine's criticisms come in these three categories, most of homeopathy's criticisms come in this one. And I hope it's clear why we should pay more attention to criticisms of a medicine's effectiveness rather than the other categories. You should pay attention to all the criticisms, but you should also be aware that anyone can make medicine that's ineffective but available and affordable. The only reason homeopathy survives is by making sure its customers are ill-informed or uninformed. Videos like these that are supportive of homeopathy only make that problem worse, much worse I should say, because there are some people that hear, hey, there are these criticisms of homeopathy and they may be careful of using it, but if they watch this video, they might start turning a blind eye towards these criticisms. Now that he's reassured people that there's so many good things about homeopathy. Towards the end of the video, he cites two studies and I want to talk about them. The first is this one, which is published in a French homeopathy journal. And like I said before, most such studies in such journals are engaged in the business of legitimizing homeopathy rather than new and cutting-edge research on new treatment methodologies for diseases. These kinds of papers never get relevant citations outside of homeopathy circles. If you don't want to go by any of what I've said, then you can go ahead and read the paper. As always, I'll leave the link in the description, unlike him. There's literally no testing done on patients in the study to draw conclusions on homeopathy. It's just a paper saying this is possible. Yeah, anything is possible, but nothing should be relied upon unless it has evidence showing its effectiveness. The second study that he cites says right here that it's not the homeopathic medication that's beneficial, it's the consultation. It says, the team now plans to conduct more research into identifying which elements of the consultation process are most beneficial. So if the consultation process is what is effective, then it has nothing to do with homeopathy, right? I mean, it could have been any other system of medicine and with the same kind of consultation, the results would be the same, right? Either way, like a true apologist, he concludes that homeopathy is really effective in these cases, in these diseases, which is what he says right after.
Upper respiratory tract infection ya arthritis mein kai bari homeopathy bahut kargar sabit hoti hai.
Here are my questions to an open letter. Why not declare your sources like I always do in the description? Are you trying to make it harder to find the actual research? Also, why only these studies? That seems extremely selective when there are a lot more studies that talk about how homeopathy is ineffective. Maybe your support of things like homeopathy or the Ayush ministry are more important to you than facts or evidence. As he concludes the video, he mentions a quote by Dr. Shantanu Abhyankar, former homeopath and current modern medicine doctor, on how all schools of medicine have good ideas that should be adopted for the betterment of society. How do I find out what he actually thinks about all this? How about I ask Dr. Shantanu himself? Hi, doctor. How are you?
Hi. Namaste.
First, I want to ask you, why did you leave homeopathy for modern medicine, or what this channel Open Letter calls allopathy?
Actually, I took up homeopathy without knowing what exactly it was. I took up homeopathy for the reason most other students take up these courses. That is because I didn't get into modern medicine. But then by the time I passed out of the college, I was convinced that homeopathy was a pseudoscience. The principles that they taught us were obviously against the very grain of basic physics and chemistry. But I left the college convinced that I am not going to be a homeopath.
I want to ask you, what did you think about the video I showed you? And what do you think about the way he quoted you, way he used what you said?
Actually, he's quoted me at the very end of the video. And rather than me saying something, he said that I believe that homeopathy needs to be scrutinized, which is correct. Of course, homeopathy needs to be scrutinized. In fact, any claim about human health and pharmacology needs to be scrutinized in the same way, regardless of who makes the claim. Whether it is from the Ayurvedic stable or the homeopathic stable or Yunani or some other Inca medicine or whatever. Every claim needs to be scrutinized and we have to know what is the correct position. Just because something is traditional, something is being followed for centuries together, does not automatically make it safe and effective. So that is what it is. At the end of the video, the conclusion has to be that homeopathy needs to be questioned time and again. There is no iota of science involved in the theories that they propound, and the drugs that are so-called effective are not actually effective when they are scrutinized in the scientific and statistical manner.
I'm aware that by making a response video in English, I won't be reaching nearly as many people. It's in moments like these that I wish I could make good videos in Hindi, but I guess I'll have to rely on you to carry the message of my video to as many people as possible, especially the ones who might fall prey to this. If you want to learn a little more about alternative medicines and what their flaws are, you can watch my channel. I have an entire playlist. I'll see you in the next video. Till then, remember, science is dope.